We are a San Francisco-based early-stage venture capital firm. We invest both in US and India. About half of our companies are US companies, and the other half are companies from India targeting the global market. And for these companies, we help them set up their international presence, help them set up their Valley office, help them with the go-to-market in the US, help them build a team suitable for the US market, help them with the future capital, the growth stage capital there. Welcome Phani. I think Phani, most of you know Phani. Phani was co-founder of redBus and most recently has taken the chief innovation officer role at Telangana. So please join me in welcoming Phani. So just to give more context about what we're going to talk about. So I do a series of couple of years in Silicon Valley. And I'll start with a little bit about my background so you have a little bit more context as to why I do what I do. So I'm originally from Delhi. I grew up in Delhi. I did my undergrad from there, and then I moved to the US in the late 90s. I went for grad school. I did my master's in computer science. I did an MBA. And I was part of the startup industry in the Valley. I was part of a startup in the late 90s in the CDN space. We used to accelerate the internet infrastructure. Within a few months of my joining, we were acquired for about $450 million. You know, it felt good. I'm still a young student, but I have some money. But very quickly, in 2001, the bubble burst, and it all evaporated. So I got a very quick lesson that these valuations are very flimsy. So unless the companies have the right fundamentals, they don't last. So after that, I was part of another startup called Andiamo. We used to make data center switches. In 2004, we were acquired by Cisco in 2004 for about $1.3 billion. Then I was heading a group in Cisco for a few years. After that, I ended up moving to venture capital. I was with a firm called Bloomberg Capital in San Francisco. We used to invest in both US and Israel. And I got really good understanding of and experience working with Israeli companies and how they build global startups out of Israel. And after that, I was with a firm called Nexus Venture Partners, which has offices in Bangalore, Bombay. And I was in the Silicon Valley office with Nexus, looking at both the companies in the US as well as companies out of India targeting the US market. So I was able to apply some of the lessons from Israel onto Indian companies. And then I started Emerging Ventures about 1.5 years ago. And over the years, one of my big passions is around yoga and meditation. I spend about a couple of hours on that every day. And my observation over the last many years, both as an operator as well as a VC, is one of the biggest, in fact, the biggest factor what make entrepreneurs succeed and which companies succeed to large scale is really the ability of the entrepreneur to manage themselves. You know, how they manage their energy, how they manage their mind, body, emotions, and how do they build that inner strength. And that's the most critical facet, more than anything else, in my experience. And so in these plain talks, we often talk to successful entrepreneurs. But of course, we do talk about what they do, in the company and experience. But we also explore their inner journey, about how did they deal with some of their challenges they face inside. How did they deal with stress? How did they deal with different challenges and situations they were faced? And because this is often a side which is underappreciated, and so we'll be exploring, different aspects. And we'll of course also have audience questions, so you're also, can bring up some of your things that are your burning questions and bring it up. So without further ado, so let me we have Phani here. So Phani, you of course had a great phenomenal journey over the years. Growing up, what was your how was that like? Did you ever think you would be an entrepreneur, and what motivated you to be an entrepreneur?
So growing up, I don't know if I thought I'll be an entrepreneur, but I think what motivated to be an entrepreneur, we keep telling ourselves that we are like accidental entrepreneurs, right? We never thought of entrepreneurship. And actually in 2005, when we started, there was no entrepreneurship, right? In the sense, okay, there were entrepreneurs certainly, but this kind of entrepreneurship, right? There was no ESL in any college. There was no incubation, there was no acceleration, there was no VC. Every VC who's we raise money from is their first fund, first VC, right? I mean, the kind of VC ecosystems. Economic Times covered no startups. There was no your story. There was nothing, right? And hence, naturally, we didn't think we were like getting into entrepreneurship. But during that time, right, I'm talking about a time before there was Android, right? And before there was even Facebook, right? Around the time when, about a year ago, when YouTube was released, right? And it all appears like many decades ago, but it is just like maybe 10 years ago.
It's like we were born with it, you know?
Yeah. I mean, even I can't believe that, oh my God, there was no Android when we started, right? But I mean, the things change so rapidly, right? But at that point in time, open source was big. I mean, all of us just fresh out of college, right? We just got our desktops then, and then we would install the excitement was to install Linux in it and then play with it and actually throw away Windows and et cetera. So that was the era, right? And then I went to Bangalore on a job. I studied electronics here and was fascinated with electronics. Actually, as a child, electronics was like magic to me, right? I mean, you just switch on a light, I mean, you switch on a switch here and the fan rotates, right? I mean, for me, that was like magic. I mean, there's no connection between this and the fan, but the fan rotates, right? And then I got into electronics, actually. I had a small electronics kit. I used to open every, I had a solder gun and all those things. And got into electronics as a choice. Incidentally, I was a state ranker in the state, but still I chose to get into electronics, got into electronics. Then subsequently got into Texas Instruments, where my job was to design ASICs. And the life was set, right? Life was so set that all my bachelor friends, right? I mean, for all of us, it's a job, and the job was like you get money in your hand and you don't have to study, right? I mean, when you just come out of the college, no exams, nothing, and money in your hand, right? But still, I used to like read up those electronics books and work till 2 a.m. in the night, and my friends used to say, oh, padhai ka din ho gaya. I mean, that is all over, right? I mean, why are you still studying? But it was a passion to me. But anyway, and my parents are from Nizamabad, which is like 150 kilometers from here, and I'm in Bangalore, so I used to take buses frequently. And then those 2 years when I was working, always when I went to an agent, he gave me a ticket, but during Diwali of 2005, when I went to that agent, he couldn't get me a ticket. But I mean, many of you probably know the story, just when I was leaving that office, then he said maybe another agent could get the ticket. That intrigued me. I was thinking, if you are an agent to bus operators, you should know whether or not there is any seat which is going vacant from Bangalore to Hyderabad. Why is that? Somebody else would know, but you won't know. But anyway, I ended up going to these 2-3 other agents, and none of them could get me a seat, which meant that I had to stay in Bangalore for that long weekend. But next day when I woke up, all my bachelor friends had gone, and I was alone in the flat. And that still bothered me. Like, maybe I didn't go to the right agent. Maybe there was a bus which went vacant from Bangalore to Hyderabad, which had that vacant seat. Which means it was a loss to that bus operator who would have spent the same fuel, same everything, but just went with one seat vacant. It was lost to an agent that I went to because he didn't call the right bus operator. It was a loss to me because I desperately wanted that seat but just didn't know where the seat was. Right? And coming from like internet engineering, I mean not internet, but coming from kind of an engineering background, the answer was very obvious to me. Like, why can't there be a centralized system where every bus operator just publishes their inventory, and you go to an agent and that agent just sees which of these operators have a seat and calls only that operator. I mean, it was just obvious, right? I mean, I was thinking why people didn't do it, right? Then I kind of, because open source was big, we said, okay, we'll write this open source software and give it to the bus operators, and when bus operators use it, all of us would benefit, right? And it was a nice weekend project that we launched. Right, and then one thing led to another. It ended up as a business, and then kind of became entrepreneurs. Right, ended up raising capital and etc. and all. And 3 years ago, we sold, exited. Yeah.
So in those days, when you just made the switch from working on it as a project to jumping on it full time, right? What was that like? I mean, you have the security of a job and you're giving that up. There's so many questions in your mind about the, you know, co-founder and also once you do that, what were some of that, the thought process at that time and how did you overcome some of the challenges at that, in that same time?
Yeah, so this is exactly the kind of questions which were asked in that era. Now nobody asks, right? I mean, people don't ask what made you leave your nice paying job to get into entrepreneurship, and people ask if you don't get into entrepreneurship, what is making you stay at that MNC even after 10 years, right? So this is question, I mean, I'm facing this question after maybe several years. But yeah, at that point in time, so we got into it as an open source. So there was no fear of leaving our jobs and et cetera, right? And then after we got into it, we created the software, went to the bus operators, started giving them the software. 3 months passed by, nobody was taking the software, right? And then we didn't know what to do. If they don't use, then all the work that we put in, or even more, the dream that we had that they use the software would not come out, right? So we just didn't know how to proceed. And I was asking around my friends and et cetera. So one friend, I mean, Texas Instruments shares a wall with Motorola. So this guy was working in Motorola. I don't know how we became friends because we are not in touch right now. And I don't know, like, where is he right now and et cetera. But he said in one conversation, he said, I remember Texas Instruments cafeteria, he said, there is this thing called Thai. Why don't you just go there, right? Then I Googled up about Thai and realized there's a Thai Bangalore chapter, went and applied there, became a member there. And then they incidentally just then started a program called EAP, Entrepreneurship Acceleration Program. And we applied to it and we got selected. First batch, first cohort. And that is when we got the mentors. And we posed the same question to them. We said, okay, the answer is obvious. And we created the solution and we were giving it free, nobody is taking it. What should we do, right? And then those mentors asked us the question as to, you have to go back and ask the bus operator as to what he needs, right? At that point in time, I don't know, I mean, I think a lot of good luck. At that point in time, we could have said, okay, you're sitting in this AC office and then asking us the same question. I mean, all the last 6-7 months, we have asked him and we figured out what he wants and that is what we created. But we took the other route and we said, okay, fine, if we anyway are not making progress here, let us just go back to the bus operator and ask him as to what he needs, right? So thankfully we went back to the bus operator and then we asked him, okay, what do you need, right? If you don't take this, what do you need? In general, what do you need, right? Then in those conversations, Tuck came back the answer saying that we don't need anything. We don't need software, we don't need... and our pitch was, you use our software, your operation efficiency goes up, you will save time. If you're employing 7 people, now you'll employ only 3 people, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and all that. He was saying, I don't need more time, I don't need software, I don't need to employ less people, I don't need anything, right? I don't need anything that you're offering me, I just don't need, right? Then we asked, okay, what do you need, right? Then he said, I mean, the operator said, we don't need anything, we just need customers. If you can get me more customers, I'll buy more buses, business runs, right? And then that insight was very useful. We came back and discussed with our mentors. He doesn't need this, or he doesn't need any of this, he just needs customers. Then the mentor said, just go do that, right? And then the whole thing changed, and thankfully changed, because after you put in like 6-7 months into that software with a lot of passion and et cetera, you don't feel like just dropping it and taking a completely tangential route, which has nothing to do with it, right? There's a lot of emotional connect. There is that fear of making a fool of yourself, saying, what is it, right? But thankfully, again, something happened to us and we said, okay, we'll drop this and then we'll just go the consumer side. Then we launched the redbus.in website. Otherwise, it was an ERP for bus operators, right? And we had the consumer side in mind, but we said, okay, once they use the software, we have access to inventory, mm-hmm. and then we sell on internet, right? Because somebody comes on internet, if he doesn't see the inventory, what will he do? He can't buy, right? But compare it to a physical office. When somebody comes to your office, what does the agent do? He'll make you sit, pick up the phone, call the operator, find out the seats, and you're engaged. You're just not leaving. But on internet, it doesn't happen that way. He just comes, inventory is not there, he just goes away. Mm-hmm. And you don't even know who's coming mm-hmm. on real time, right? So we said, okay, our problem right now is to get the bus operator customers, right? How do we figure out a solution to that is what we need to figure out with all these constraints. The consumer doesn't come, that is, you don't know who is coming in and et cetera. We dropped that whole software for bus operators, created redbus.in, and the challenge is what will you put there, right? When we went back to the operators, and again in the conversations we said, okay, what can we do? Can you give us some seats? He said, no, I can't give you seats, and et cetera, et cetera. In those conversations, we came across another insight. Another insight is the bus tickets get sold only 2 days before the departure. I mean, the primary mode of transportation is train. If you don't get train, you go by bus. I mean, during those days, the roads were terrible. The buses were terrible. There were no air-conditioned buses. The Volvo buses had just then come in about a year ago or 2 years ago, and et cetera. So it's a very different this thing. So people prefer train, not buses, and et cetera. So bus seats would get sold only 2 days before the departure. Then with that insight, we went back to the bus operator and said, okay, fine. Anyway, you're opening your book only 2 days before the departure. So give us the inventory until 2 days before the departure. And when you open it, if I sell one seat, it's a bonus. You're starting with one seat, right? Earlier, you were starting with zero. And that was an easy thing to say yes to him, right? Then he said, okay, fine, take it, right? And but that too, he said, I'll give you only two seats. He said, okay, whatever, give us two seats, right? Then again, different challenges. You get two seats. I mean, we were stationed in Bangalore. From Bangalore, buses go to 300 locations, right? 300 different destinations. Go to Kerala, go to Mumbai, go to Chennai, go to Hyderabad, Tirupati, you name it, right? Coimbatore, like 300 different places. Hubli, Mangalore, Mysore, etc., and all that. And now you have convinced one operator who's given you two seats, and that bus operator has five buses, which means he is going to find only five locations out of the 300 locations, right? Now, how do you go to market, right? How do you go and tell customers, come on to my site? Because if people from Bombay come in and you don't have inventory, right, you're disappointing so many more people, and the fear is they will never come back again, right? So one challenge after the other, but I think every time there are answers which just come to you, and then you implement it and then solve that problem, yeah.
You know, I'm chair for Thai San Francisco, so I'm very happy that Thai was useful in your journey. So it's very common, I've seen that you often, many people are sitting in the same meeting, but they all hear very different things because everybody has very different ways of listening and different levels of paying attention. So you talked a lot about how you went back multiple times and listened. How did your listening ability, you know, how listening means so many different things to different people. How you listen, how did that change during this time?
I mean, people say I'm a good listener. I don't know. I don't know the structure of it. But I mean, I think if you really, really want to do something, right, by your, I mean, first thing I think is you should really, really want to do it, right? And that real confidence from inside come when you answer many of these questions.
Correct.
Why do you want to do that? And really face the, be a devil's advocate in your own mind, right? I mean, instead of just trying to convince somebody, right? And be willing to leave everything. Like, okay, you created a software, now it doesn't work. That attachment you lose, you have to leave because you have to make progress and not what you have done and et cetera, right? I mean, all those things I think just fall in place if you have that deep desire, right? That you really want to do it, then automatically, like I was, I mean, and I can also relate to it. I became much, much more patient. Like I'm much more tolerant and patient now than like 10 years ago when we started out. 10 years ago when we started out, I used to control every pixel on the site, right? That this color has to be only this and this button has to be only this size and it has to be red. It has to be just like that. Right, and no questions asked, nothing, because I know that's how it works, right? But it didn't go far. And what I wanted was the company to go forward. What I wanted was people, I mean, that thing, right, that every bus operator should use it and this whole industry should change, right? For which, if it is not making progress to that, just because I want to control every pixel, you will automatically leave it. You will automatically let other people control the pixels, everything, because you want to get there, right? I think the deep desire sets everything right. But you need to really, really, really have that very, very strong desire.
Regarding that first guy that gave you his first book on the pre-2 days, do you still remember him? Do you still know who he is? Do you maintain contact?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
It was that first guy that opened you the door, let's say. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I know all my bus operators still. Certainly, I know him. We are in touch.
Do you guys build like a community within them?
So they are our customers. No? They're bus operators. There are about 2,000 bus operators in India. And it's only 2,000. And you're facing them every day. I mean, at least until 3 years ago. So there's no way not to know them, right? I not only know them, but in some cases, I know their families as well, right? I mean, it is that. And also, there's another thing, like when we were getting into this business of bus industry, right? The most concerned, you were saying, okay, how did you convince your parents and what are the concerns and et cetera. In that time, right, I mean, my parents were fine because, I mean, my childhood and et cetera, right? Actually, though I say Nizamabad, my parents were in a village. Mm-hmm. My father is a farmer and et cetera. And they wanted me to get English medium education and our village didn't have an English school, so they put me in hostel in kindergarten. So I went to a kindergarten. I mean, I was in hostels all through and et cetera and all, and Bits again was a hostel and et cetera. And they pretty much kind of trust my gut, right? I mean, in a sense, okay, because I always like got a state rank here, got a distinction in Bits, got a job. Then when I said I want to do a company, it was an easy decision from their side. I mean, because they anyway also can't make sense of all this, right? But the most worried was my supervisor at Texas Instruments. He was saying that, where are you going? What have you studied? You studied electronics, you are doing this, you enjoy this thing. You are getting into bus industry, bus agent, and that too, the bus operators, right? Even now, many of us have this perception, it's also true in some cases, that you take bus industry, many of them are like rowdies, gangsters. You open paper, you will see mafia. I mean, the word mafia is always attached to bus industry, right? Or bus mafia, etc., and all that. And they also behave that way, and many of them are politicians and etc. That is the industry, if you take the private bus industry, right? So my manager was saying, what are you getting into, right? I mean, it's just, you have to think through and don't get into it. It is a mafia, and it is black money, right? And it was black money, right? But we had a mentor who said, if you are able to get him 50% more business, the guy will convert to white, because he has to pay only 30% tax, still he is profitable, right? And that happened. Even our investors, when we went to raise money, they said, oh, this industry is black money. And every transaction that you're doing is through credit card because you're selling on internet, you will have a cap. They will not allow you to sell more than 10% of their tickets. Today we are selling, online is selling almost 80-90% of the, all 100% actually. Even if he sells in his office, it's sold on internet, right? So all these things will, all these things will change. And the thing I was saying is the families, right? When you, I know the families, I somehow had this, I could relate to their side in the sense that I felt like they are people like us, right? They behave differently because of the situation they are in. For their business, they are CEO themselves, they are CFO themselves, they are CTO themselves, they are the chief of engineering, chief of staff. Not just that, they are also VC for their business. And that money, they would have actually collateralized their house, the house that they're living in, sometimes the family's jewelry, etc., and he got a bus, right? Obviously, he'll be very stressed. And added to that, he's not well-educated. He can't read a balance sheet and etc. He has to trust somebody. He has to control them with either fear or whatever and etc. That whole thing, imagine all those things in one person, right? It is going to be very stressful. And it will shoot out like that. Like he will whip his driver, belt his driver, because a 1 crore property is just taking, and because he just had a beer, he just goes and crashes into something, the liability of several crores and lives and all that comes to him. Mm-hmm. So obviously when that happens, he will go and bash up the driver, right? But if you're able to see from his perspective, I think it becomes so much more simpler. I mean, almost, I would say that 30% of our bus operators have a licensed gun, right? So, but that will never be your, I mean, if you're thinking from that side and able to relate to him, I mean, again, thankful that I have that there. And I have a similar feeling now in my new role as a CIO. I see all these politicians. And I mean, just yesterday I was talking to somebody and I was, we were discussing and I was telling them that, I can relate to why a politician needs a bribe. Because he has to come back and pay the vote bank, right? I mean, the day they stop taking money, right, then the politician also may not take money. Because all of them, they want to be good and nice, but they have this compulsion to make that money to invest in that vote.
So looking for an entrepreneur to solve that problem. So you're talking about, the stress that bus operators go through. On that topic, maybe let's talk about how did you manage stress? You know, what was your, how many of you are entrepreneurs here? I guess most of you? Okay. How many of you experienced stress? So what was your, how did you, what was your journey through that? What was your tools you used to handle that?
Yeah, I think some simple things, I mean, during that time was, there were quite a few times when I went to a movie all by myself, right? Just, I found that as a good therapy also, because when you get into a theater, I mean, what is stress? I mean, stress is something like something wrong happens or unexpected, unplanned thing happens and that keeps rewind replay in your mind, right? I mean, it just keeps on rewind replay without control, right? You know, okay, it has happened. You lost that customer, but it still keeps rewind replay and that is what causes stress, not just the event, right? But to stop that, you have to fill your mind with something else. So I used to just go to a movie, right? By just myself, right? No, anything, whatever is running, right? I mean, you just go to a nearby. I mean, it's not for the movie, but you just go there, right? And those are the only times when I went alone. I mean, usually you don't go alone, right? I mean, it's also weird, like you're sitting alone and everybody else is sitting with friends and everybody, right? So that was a good, stress buster to me because you're just, your mind for those 3 hours, right, follows another story, right? And then when you come out, you are less stressed. But there was this one situation where that also didn't work, right? I mean, 2008, the crash happened. Just before that, we had a lot of money in the, we had crore in the company and our burn was 7 lakhs a month. So in my mind, I had 1 year money, right? And then suddenly some unplanned expense of 50 lakhs came, which means I had only 50 lakhs in the thing. And then until then, almost every VC was coming to our office and saying, we'll write you a check. So I had a lot of confidence that we just have to choose from one of them to write us a check. And one fine day, just 2008 crash happened, right? And after that, also because our 1 crore reduced to 50 lakhs, I said, we have to immediately go and raise money. So went to the market. Nobody was taking a decision to invest. All the VCs who came to us, I mean, obviously, because it's an unknown territory, so nobody would write a check. Right? And then we didn't know what to do. Then we did one round at a lower valuation than our previous valuation. And I had to face my team saying that that is the right valuation that we get. And then the team was a little disappointed that, okay, is that the reality? Is that what we are creating? I mean, are we creating only this company? Because that is what is the market saying. And all of us are like youngsters. None of us had any experience, right? And then there were resignations. Our senior management resigned, and then I was also stressed, is it what we are building, etc., and all that. I just didn't know what to do, right? I was again reading on internet to figure out what to do, and etc., and came across Vipassana. Mm-hmm. And just signed up, and I got an immediate slot. Usually you don't get slots. I got an immediate slot, went for Vipassana. Those 10 days, right? I mean, when I came back, the world was very different, and it was very useful. Yeah.
You know, it's interesting, Phanindra talks about that. More than half of the entrepreneurs in our portfolio, they practice meditation or different kinds. So we've, in fact, in our portfolio meets, we often conduct meditation sessions, and a lot of people have found immense value because of this. The every day, so many challenges are thrown at you. Being able to navigate that has been extremely, you need to have that a tool set to be able to handle that. You know, I went through a program many years ago called Inner Engineering, which I found extremely valuable and useful. But the, broadly speaking, the tool set of meditation has been extremely valuable. Since we're on that topic around people resigned and keeping the morale of the team up, let's talk about hiring. You know, what, of course, during the whole entire journey, you had to hire a lot of people. How did you assess people? How did you build that team? How did you build that culture that you felt was necessary for this company?
Yeah, so how did we hire the team? I'm a little organized person, so I used to have this Excel with the things that I want to look for. Because I feared that you get into a interview and the conversation is very good and you like the person and you just hire him. Right? Later you realize that, oh, but I wanted somebody with this thing. He didn't have it, but still I like the guy, so I took him. Right? So I didn't want to do that thing. So I created this Excel sheet with all the things that I wanted and etc. And then I would go into the interview. Also, often what happens is when you go to an interview, right, your time is fixed. Right? I mean, you will have a conversation only for an hour. Whether you like it or he has another appointment, you can't have a conversation more than an hour. Right? So that time is fixed. Now, when the time is fixed, if he's a smart interviewee, he can just fill that time with anything that he wants, right? But as a smart interviewer, you have to fill that time with your agenda rather than that. And it happens all the time. That time we think is open, but it is just finite, right? So when you have this thing, then you know what are the things that you're asking, how you're filling in, and et cetera. And I used to do hiring that way. But then, later, one thing that worked really, really well for me is, of course, I mean, in the course, I also did the same. Mine is an arranged marriage. And then my cousins and everybody asked, what are the things that you need? Then I said, I need this. I mean, right? Then my aunt came and said, just keep all that aside. It is, you just, and then I, like, arranged marriage, right? So I said, no, I can't meet a girl and say no. So checklist, everything meets, then I'll see the girl. Right? They said, boss, you just leave that, meet the girl. It's okay to say no, but meet the girl, right? Then I obviously, I mean, there was no this thing also. So I just met somebody, just liked it, and now we got married and et cetera and all. But that was a great learning for me, which my aunt gave, right? She said, just, when you like, you have a conversation, you just go forward, right? And then I changed my recruitment thing to that. So you meet a guy, talk to him. I still have that Excel sheet, which I want to fill in because I don't want to forget some points. But when you have that conversation, right, you have to just tick off well, right?
And it's about paying attention to that person. Is that, how do you, and listen very carefully to that person, is that what, How do you, as part of that meeting, how do you see that as a different meeting than other meetings?
Yeah, so there are certain things that you just have that good feel. Like, for example, I had a conversation with somebody some time back, today, and there are two people, and we were having conversation. Like, one guy said, we have to do this scale and this way and et cetera and all that. And that was like a music to me, right? The other guy said, I will give you the direction. I mean, you can do anything that you want to do, but I will only give you vision, right? So there's nothing wrong in it, but it's just that it just doesn't fit into my thinking. So for me, if you're a team, right, the vision will come out of the team. Right? It is everybody put together, and it's not like a master and slave, right? So in that conversation, what I could make out is like, okay, I won't gel well with this person, whereas I will gel well with this other person, right? It is those small things. I mean, and there is no one recipe to build a company. I mean, we all know, like if you look at the top companies, top entrepreneurs, they're all very different, right? I mean, where we say we want open culture, like what I'm talking about is probably kind of a reflection of Google's culture. I mean, you have to tell me whether it's right, right? I mean, where everybody comes in, everybody is equal, they have their own ideas, they do whatever, right? Google is a mega success. Whereas some other companies like, okay, whatever little bit we know of Steve Jobs and Amazon and et cetera, the early days, right? It is mostly like, Bezos gives a direction and people do. Now it may have changed and et cetera. Both of them are very, very successful. So there is no one way of success, but it is also your way. I mean, you like, you are this way, so you choose such people, right?
It's about, like I said, it's about building, consciously building the culture that you want to set for that company.
No, I think not even consciously. It is just subconsciously you like the kind of people that you want to hang out with, the kind of people. And very well being aware that there is no... This may not be the recipe to success, and there is no one recipe to success. And there are several recipes, right? I mean, there are bootstrapped billion-dollar companies, multi-billion-dollar companies, right? There are funded companies, many, many ways, right? But it will be an absolute failure if you are this category, but just because that other guy is like a top-notch coder, you want that skill, and you marry, I mean, you kind of have him in your team. Right, because of that skill, it will be a disaster. He can be a great guy, but you are not able to, you are always talking tangential. Rather, I would prefer somebody who is like very much like me, right? I mean, in the sense, this thing, but the skills are different, right? I mean, I'm also very conscious, like I did so many of these experiments. At one point in time, when I was going this way, I said, oh my God, what am I saying? I'm saying I will work with only people like me. And then we see the literature and people say, oh, you need to have complementary skills and you just cannot have people like you, right? And I said, oh my God, I'm doing a wrong thing, so let me get people who are not like me, right? So we got in people who are not like me. I did the interview, he was talking something else, I was talking something else, but look at his skill and experience, fantastic, right? Some top-notch guy at Facebook, Google, whatever it is, right? And I said, this skill we should have and he should come and teach me. And I should be stand corrected, right? Got him in, we just could not, right? I mean, he would say something, I would say something else, not on the subject that matters, on the soft things, right? Whether you want an open office, he would want a closed office, I would say, but we are all equal and things like that. We just wasted a lot of time that way. Neither he liked nor I liked. We just parted ways, which is a failure, right? Yeah.
I think what you're saying is the soft skills makes all the difference, you know, in terms of the ability to integrate the team together. Is that fair way of saying what you're saying?
I think you should have complementary skills,
yes,
but not complementary cultures, right? Let's say you are a conservative guy, and then there is, let's say, a very flamboyant entrepreneur. You both cannot work together, because it will just be a disaster. The skills are, I can never run meetings. I can never manage projects, right? I mean, I was so stressed, right? I mean, you have to have this delivery by that date. Everybody, the marketing team, tech team, every sales team, everybody will point to the CEO and say, you have to orchestrate everybody to meet the delivery. If that is not met, it is your problem. I was terrible at it. I cannot do it. And that is where a complementary skill is required. Somebody who enjoys doing that, but still has the same culture as me, right?
So in this process, as you hire different people and you know you brand different personalities, of course, you went through a big evolution yourself during those 9 years. What were some of the habits you felt were... you had to change to be able to go to the next level as an entrepreneur, to be able to take the company to the next level? Would love to hear any examples of that.
Yeah, I think everything. I mean, it's not just an entrepreneur or anything, right? I mean, we are always imperfect, and there is a lot of value to get to that perfection, right? I mean, there's a lot of value. It is, it will accrue over the rest of your life, right? I mean, whatever. So it's a continuous journey that you find something you want. So one of the ways is like I used to have this definition of myself, right? Well, this is how I should be, right? But the reality is very different. So many times you just, because you are clearly defined, and that is another person, right? You can have this this kind of a comparison, oh, no, that guy would not do it, so I would not do it. Yeah. So those things helped. Mm-hmm. So you have a definition, right? Mm-hmm. For example, any one of those things, like...
for example, how you would communicate with people, or how would you how would you deal with goals, or how do you deal with family or time management, anything, for example, there?
Every one of those things. Yeah. Every one of those things. On the culture, I would say that whoever is the head of that company, of that community, of that organization, the culture of that society will just reflect him. There is no way out. It will just mimic him, right? So the best way to change the culture of your company is to change yourself. Mm-hmm. And that everybody changes, everybody, like we have Mahatma Gandhi, right? I mean, there's this famous story, right? As a child, he lied, he did chori, he did all those things. But when he realized that those are not the right things or whatever it is, right, he changed. And once he changed, a lot of things happened, right? So I'm saying that all of us, I used to bribe a police cop, then I told myself that, okay, no, we should not, for whatever reason, right? Then today, you just don't. You are fine paying that. Just by paying a 5,000 rupee fine, you're not going to miss your dinner, even if you are not a successful entrepreneur, even if you are whoever you are, right? A 5,000 rupee fine will not make you skip a dinner. You'll think very differently, and then you will change. And once you change that, right, the entire organization will change. Every one of those things, right? Everything that you do it, they will do it.
It's a good time for some audience questions.
A very specific question regarding stress and managing team. So specifically, for example, when you guys were putting so much energy building that first platform, the first thingy, your first baby, and then you guys had to drop it out, did you had someone from your team, did the team react to that? Like, oh shit, I put so much effort on this and now we're gonna drop this out. Did you had people questioning your vision or something like that? Was it stressful and how did you manage with that?
No, not at all. Actually, we were such a small team. It is just three co-founders. We didn't have a team. We had two people, but they were engineers. They were like very, young. One of them is just passed out, and other one is also just passed out, not even an engineer. But even within the co-founders, right, I don't think we had any conversation like that. See, it was pretty open, right? We're not making progress, so you better do something else, right? We never had those things. And I think if you were getting into those things, then you probably have to realize that it's not going to work out, right? You are just similar. See, when you have to say that I'm the CEO, so I'll take decision. Even in the early stages, in the first few months, if that kind of a thing is there, then you are not the right partners, because this journey is 15 years, 30 years, right? You are just, things are happening automatically, right? You're all thinking alike, or you trust each other and et cetera. In our case, what will we call the company? Three of us didn't have to sit and decide. What will be the tech architecture? Three of us didn't have to sit together and decide. I was the CEO, so I went and pitched in Mumbai to a VC. They gave a term sheet there and they said, do you want to sign it? Right? I just signed without even talking to the co-founders, right? People ask this question, okay, when the term sheet came, did you all discuss, did you have a different opinion? That didn't even strike me, that I have to talk to my co-founders who are equal partners. Right? It is just, okay, I'm doing that job, though I'll just do it. And likewise, my co-founder who's handling technology is just going that path. He's never coming and asking me, okay, should we do this architecture, that architecture, right? I think that is required. So actually in co-founders, we don't complement each other at all if you look at the paper, right? We all studied in the same college, the same discipline, electronics, same gender, same place that we came from, which is Andhra, United Andhra that time. everything same. We live in the same place, same family backgrounds. Actually, my other co-founder's dad is still a farmer. They are still, so everything same. So there's nothing that we can say we complement each other. It's not like I know Java and he knows balance sheet. Yeah, all of us know only one thing, which is electronics. None of us know even Java, right? So I mean, complementary skills is good, but I think what is more important is this, that
is a trust.
You are all just together, right? I mean, you trust each other. I mean, there is no conscious question of saying, okay, should I ask him, should I take his permission? Then I think it's a failure. I mean, you're better off partnering with somebody else.
Another question?
I mean, you were just talking about your entire journey of being an entrepreneur. How different is that now with the role that you are in currently? You know, how's the contrast? Because now I'm sure you have a lot more people to talk to take opinions, to, you know, have to consult with. So how different is that now, and how's that experience?
So why are you saying that I have a lot more people to consult with?
No, you just said, like, when you guys were co-founders, you know, when you had to sign the term sheet, you signed the term sheet. But now I don't know how it is. I'm guessing because it's with the government, it's a lot more people to consult with. Is it, or am I wrong? How is that?
Okay. I, in the government, I'm only 1 month old. And I have not taken up anything yet. But government, whatever I can, I've, like, seen, not even felt, just seen from outside, is government is completely opposite. Government is, if you're in a role, you have complete, unlimited executive powers, right? You don't have to consult, you don't have to take opinions, you don't have to get people in and etc. and all that and buy in, right? Because they always say, okay, he's the minister, he's the CM, he's the secretary, he is CIO, he's this, so whatever he says, we should do. Right? I mean, that is the thing. It is a very different thing. And also, like the whole org structure, because it is also not equals. Like, where in a company, you are from whatever IIT, IIM, whatever, IIIT, and etc. Everybody else is also so. Right? It's just that you said you want to do it, and people joined you. So it is actually first amongst equals. Everybody is an equal. Or actually, many, many times, the others are much better than you. Whereas here, the whole org structure is like that you don't have every, I mean, your whole team is not filled with the likes of you. So it is very different in government. But if I were to answer it, the later years of redBus, when we had like 600-700 people and et cetera, right? So there, again, where, like I said, I was this control freak where I was controlling every pixel, and we just could not make progress, right? And if you don't make progress, it's the end of it, right? So somehow I realized that, and I was like very excited to go to work every day. Right, you just wake up with new ideas, right? You want to have this feature, that feature, this thing. You just wake up with this bright idea and excitement to just go to office and get that thing done, right? And hence the control freakness and et cetera and all that. But then I realized that we are not making progress. Something, I mean, I don't know how it happened, but then I realized that what if the 6-7 people in my team, right? What if they come with the same excitement, right? Every day they wake up with ideas, they just come and do it, right? I mean, the excitement that I'm going through, the joy of that creation, right? And I said, okay, that will be multiplication of what we are doing by several times. If there are 10 people, then it is 10x the path, the pace, right? I said, oh, that is what we need to do. But after just stating that, the doing is very, very difficult. Like, 2 years I had to go through a personal trauma to let others do things, right, and not you doing things, right? First of all, you have to kill your excitement. Second of all, you are responsible for the business, and it will certainly be 2 steps behind when they're just transitioning from doing to also figuring out their own ideas, because some of the ideas you already tried, but they have not tried. It could also be because you failed because it was a wrong time, good idea at the wrong time. Right? I mean, bus ticketing is not new. I mean, when we went to the bus operators, they said, oh, it has failed. 99.com bubble, many people created bus ticketing websites, it didn't work. Right? Then later, again, 2003, somebody created, didn't work. Now you're coming in 2005, it won't work. Right? But for us, it worked because it is at the right time. Right? So like that, even the ideas that you experimented and failed, just because somebody in your team is doing at a different point in time, at a different this thing, it may work. But even if it fails, I think the joy of letting him do, right, come back with more ideas and just own it up will just do so much to your company. And imagine everybody is doing that, right? It is your job as to how will you enable it, because there'll be chaos, right? And all our education system and all of us, right? I mean, we have all grown up, not just here, actually, when I spent in the US, yeah. Right? There also I realized that there it is even more worse. It is, the individualism is so much more than what is here, right? I was doing psychology in Stanford when we met, yeah. And there they were giving example that, oh, in East, people actually respect others' opinion and they work together, but in West, it is individualism, right? And I was thinking, oh my God. I thought we were worse and US is even worse, right? But because for whatever, if you're an entrepreneur at 22 years, right? 22 years of your life, you had seen only one kind, which is you control everything, you study, you get the marks, you are there. You never played a team sport where you let the other guy, right, hit the goal and just pass the ball to him so that he hits the goal. It's never done in life, right? And suddenly, as a startup to do, right? I mean, 22 years of history you leave and then in 22 months you have to change is very difficult. But I think if you just go through that journey, it will be fantastic. I mean, I'm still in that journey. It's not like now anybody who works with me will say, oh, we are having a ball because we can do everything that we want. But it's an ongoing thing. But if you can get that excitement, right? It is just... you'll just propel those two seats, right? We chose that. We said, if you are able to make this person win, everybody else will follow. And if you're not able to make him win, then you don't have a business, you don't have this thing, you wind up and go back, right? So we always focused on what we have. You have this guy with two seats, you have to fill those seats. Now, how do you, now the whole problem statement, right, is changed to this. Like, you have the seats, how do you fill that? Right, then comes the customer acquisition, right? So, like when you just have this question, you want to solve it, right? Everybody you meet, you'll ask this question, right? So incidentally, we had this operator who is from Telugu, who is from, I think, Rayalaseema. So he had operated buses to Tirupati, he had bus to Hyderabad and etc. And we had to sell that, right? So how do you go to, even if you want to distribute pamphlets and etc., right? How do you know who is the Telugu-speaking guy here, right? You give it to Malayali, then is a wrong acquisition, right? We had this question and we were asking, and then we realized two, three sources, one of which is Just Dial. I mean, that time Just Dial was very famous and etc. Actually, until we sold redBus, I don't know if they still do it, but until we sold redBus, we were still working with Just Dial leads, right? So in Just Dial, what you get is the guy is saying, okay, I want a bus from Bangalore to Tirupati. Can you give me travel agents? It is a very well qualified lead. You just buy out that sector. You be the diamond member there, you buy out every lead there, right? You get them, convert them, get them, convert them. That is one way. The second way was, during that time, SEM was not there. I mean, now though you can even target that keyword and say, okay, we want that customer. You can target on Facebook and 20 other ways. But that time that was not there. I mean, that whole thing was not there. The internet population was not there. Search engine, I don't know even if whole thing was there. Then the other thing we realized is actually people live in clusters, right? That was a great insight. I'm from Nizamabad, so 90% of my cousins and my aunts and uncles and everybody just stays in Boinpalli and that side. Right, we don't know what is Dilsukh Nagar, we don't know what is High Tech City, we don't know any one of these things. Why is that? I mean, you could have spread across all over the city, right? But just there, because that's the entry point of Nizamabad, we are familiar, so we just stay there, right? So people live in that clusters. So if you have a bus running from Hyderabad to Nizamabad, you don't have to market in High Tech City or Gachibowli or anywhere, or Dilsukh Nagar or anywhere. You just have to market in Boinpalli. Right, because 80% of your customers are there, right? So that is another big insight which helped us just focus, right? You have buses to, in Bangalore, right? I mean, you have buses to Tamil Nadu, you just spend every dollar in BTM layout. I mean, there's a place called BTM layout, HSR layout, you just spend there, right? you have buses to Kerala, you spend in Madiwala, right? I mean, that is where people live, right? That's the second thing that worked, and there are two, three other things that worked. But what I'm saying is, when you have that question and keep asking yourself, keep asking everybody else, whoever you meet and et cetera, you will get that answer, right? Yeah, and in terms of customer acquisition, right? I mean, we actually were more word of mouth. Actually, I mean, today when I say redBus, everybody says Allu Arjun, but we never did TV ads, we never did any one of those things until we sold, right? It was only word of mouth, and it works fantastically, right? See, if even if there are 10 customers on your site, right? These 10 customers have know about you, they have taken time out of their schedule, come there, looked at something and etc. and all. And now your duty is to analyze, put analytics there and see what he has looked at. Where is the funnel dropping? Why is he dropping there? And even have a call with him, prompt him to give his phone number. Just call him, do the raw things, right? Just call him and say, what were you looking for? Why did you not book? What is that? You'll get immense insights. Now the second big thing is once you get that insights, you just go and work on those insights. Instead of saying, okay, I'll have 50 lakhs as a marketing dollars because I want, now 10 people are coming, I want 100 more people to come because that will also increase your sales. But I would say these 10 people, just talk to them, convert them, right? And that will in turn get you those 100 people automatically without spending any money, right? So, I mean, that's one way to do it. I mean, whoever you have, work with them. Right, I mean, whether customers, bus operators, whatever resources you have, work with them instead of worrying about all the other things that you don't have.
Funny, firstly, thank you for sharing your personal journey. It's truly relatable as an entrepreneur and inspirational, you know, as a wannabe successful entrepreneur. The world has known you as, you know, Funny, the successful CEO, successful entrepreneur. But what is to expect from, you know, Funny, the CIO of Telangana?
Oh my God.
That's my first question.
No pressure.
Okay. Second one, as you said, being non-entrepreneur to be an entrepreneur itself is a transition. Now you're transitioning from an entrepreneur to a role which might not give you the kind of freedom you otherwise would have had, you know, in your own organization. So, I mean, that too, you're a part of a government organization as well. So I'm sure you're going to have challenges. In spite of Telangana being a very progressive organization, I'm still in a state, still you might have those challenges. So, I mean, I'm more, you know, keen to understand what is it we expect over the next, you know, year or so as an innovation part, you know, as a CIO, what is your mandate and what are we going to expect?
Yeah. So, I mean, I would say don't expect anything. Imagine that I was not there. I'll also tell you, I mean, you also asked about stress, right? So, the first few days I came here, and then you come from startup world, and then where I wanted to hire always best people, people better than me, just work with them, and this whole creative journey and they are actually educating you than you telling them what needs to be done and et cetera, right? And like I mentioned, it is a little different here. So I came here and then I had to do something. And I felt like it is just so crazy. And government is just wasting money on that and it should just not happen, right? So my first instinct is to just jump in and stop that, right? And I was almost there. I just jumped in and said, no, this should not happen. We are not spending money. We are just not doing it, right? And that night I went back and I was thinking, it is so this thing, et cetera, and all that, right? But then later I realized that, I have to kind of reorient myself, right? I am in a different situation. I mean, I am in a different organization, which is functions very differently. They have its own constraints, very different, right? And I told myself that, I mean, that is actually what even KTR pitched to me, saying that, okay, without you, we'll do whatever we want. With you, even if like 2 inches moves in a different direction, we are happy with it, right? Then that night, I was telling myself that, okay, I will not want to change anything here, right? Then it will be a very different journey, which will not materialize into everything, anything. You can't change, right? I oriented myself saying that without me, things are happening the way they are happening. With me, if they can just change 2 inches in a different direction, I will consider myself as a successful in my role, right? So the next day we had a follow-on meeting. I went to that meeting and I said, no, maybe we can do it this way. Maybe this is a suggestion, without really owning it up, without really saying that, no, we should do it, own this thing, right? I just kind of gave an advice and et cetera and all that. And now we had another meeting recently. I am so glad that at least 50% of them are incorporated into the, I mean, it changed not just by 2 inches, but I think it has changed by 2 feet, which I am very happy about, and it gave me a lot of learning. I mean, if it were in redBus, right, I would actually little push further also, because I would feel like I'm in charge of that whole thing, right? But the learning for me here is, I mean, even if I had pushed, right, on that, in that meeting and et cetera, maybe I would have reached only 40%, right? Because people get irritated and they say, okay, you're pushing so much, so I'll get something, right? But without pushing, now I got 50% of what I wanted. Right.
But any objective, goals that you or the government of Telangana have in their mind towards this innovation, more objective, as in this is what we're planning to over the next couple of years, and this is what we're looking forward to. Because when T-Hub was formed, such kind of goals have been laid as well.
Correct.
Okay. So any such kind of objective goals?
Yeah, so it's very similar. I mean, that also is another thing, right? I mean, when you do org structures in our companies, we say if there is a CMO, you don't get a sales head unless it is like very deeply required, because you know that CMO can do a similar thing. So you don't just get people in, right? But anyway, so I think our objective is also very similar. Like, I mean, the government wants Hyderabad as one of the top innovation hubs, right? And broadly, the whole of state of Telangana, right? So they have this vision and they want to see what can be done to get there, right? What should be done, right? So I'll be working on that, whether, I mean, we reach there, I don't think we'll reach there in certainly 3 years, 4 years, and et cetera. It is a much longer thing. Even if you're in that path, it'll be 5 years, or it'll be suddenly one fine day, we'll just wake up to seeing huge activity happening in Bangalore, right, in Hyderabad, right? So I don't know when it'll happen. And also to be less stressful, I'm also orienting myself that, okay, you do things in the right direction, things will happen, right? But right now I'm spending more time on immersion. I'm trying to understand what is there. And I must say that I'm like so fascinated with what is already there. I mean, there's like so many things that are happening in Hyderabad, yeah.
And you talked about, you know, changing by 2 inches. Underestimate the power of change of 2 inches. If you have a ship, you know, change angle by 2 degrees in a quarter of time, it'll completely reverse course.
But what is the right 2 inches change in my mind could also be the wrong 2 inches, because, and then you will end up in some other place. I mean, it is unproven, but yeah.
It's why not commercial vehicles? It's only why bus, train, flights in the red bus, I see. Because we deal with the farm produce products. We see a lot of farmers facing issues. Like if they have a half ton, a 1 ton, couldn't be able to find the commercial vehicles sometimes. So that local agent, grab the material, because they have dealings with other commercial vehicle dealers. There are few individuals, they run their own commercial vehicles. Okay, they are unable to get the leads. And at the same time, the farmers in the rainy season or busy time, unable to get the vehicles. So it's like a request or advice, because we deal with thousands of farmers in different locations. So I have seen this actually. I had idea also, like, why not commercial vehicles?
Yeah.
So club it and, you know, just...
So the question is, why didn't he do commercial vehicles?
Yes, yeah, why?
So that you could do it.
No, actually, the question is, why not commercial vehicles? Like, you felt like it's very difficult to...
Yeah, so I have an answer for it. Yes. We did it very consciously. I mean, in our case, it was more like, why not flight tickets, right? And if a bus ticket is 500 rupees, flight ticket is 5,000 rupees. And at the same margin, right, even if you, like, you just launch flight tickets on your site, even if 10% of your customers are buying flight tickets, which is 10 times more expensive, your top line just doubles, right? With no bottom line expense, with no additional marketing expense, with no other expense. If your top line doubles, every revenue that makes goes to your bottom line, right? Bottom line more than doubles, right? So our investors and well-wishers and everybody said, why not do airline tickets, right? It's just a no-brainer, because there are only 5 airline companies in India, whereas your technology is already integrated with 2,000 bus operators, which means even from technology standpoint, it is not much, right? And consumer standpoint, you don't have to do anything. It made a lot of, I mean, from that perspective, business sense. But for us, what the way we thought is, okay, that means you need 10% more technology, 10% more bandwidth, and et cetera, and all that. And then when we look at bus ticketing in our own thing, right, every time you look at the roadmap that your team has or you have, and et cetera, right, you always have the next 4 quarters roadmap, right? You say that, okay, I want to do this feature, okay, but right now I have only so many engineering staff or so much, so I'll do it in next quarter and the next quarter. So that is always, you have a roadmap for 4 quarters, right? Then we said, if we have 10% more bandwidth, right, that we'll put back in this, getting that four quarters roadmap, achieving much faster, because we're never falling short of what we can do with bus ticketing, rather than do a new thing, right? And that has its own advantages. One deep advantage is, you see, you and your competitors, right? All of them equally same talented, equal money, same money. I mean, VCs invest in you, VCs invest in them. Everything remains the same. So why should you have an edge over anybody else? That is because you are maybe a few miles ahead, or you are giving much more time to this than anybody else, right? Every minute of your life you are putting that Saturday and Sunday, whereas you hope that your competitor has gone for a movie on Saturday, right? That is the only way to win. Unless you say that, okay, my competitor is not as smart as me, which is the wrong thing. Everybody is more smart, or at least equally smart, right? Then how will you get that winning edge? Because you put everything back into this. And once you put that back in, right, I mean, you make much more progress and et cetera and all that. There will be a time where you don't have 4 quarters roadmap. Everything that you conceived and et cetera is already done, right? You can't do anything. That is when probably you can do the other things, right? And that is a time to do other things, but until then, you just focus on what you're doing.
Why not commercial vehicles?
I think it's, I mean, it could be a good idea, but why we didn't do it is this reason.
They couldn't able to grab the market, and the farmers, you know, because of that gambling, you know, they charge high and...
So right now I'm an investor in a company which is doing that, which is good, right? I mean, anyway, I mean, I believe in that idea. I believe in that aggregation, and somebody else is doing it, and you get a ride.
Yeah, if you have a strong desire, like funny, to do it, then you should do it.
That's the reason I asked the question, or else I could have planned something.
All right, so... please join me in thanking Phani. It's a great to have you here. And thanks to all of you for joining us. You know, we do these plane talks regularly. We've done with many entrepreneurs, you know, across both US and here. So if you'd like to stay in touch with us, be invited to future events, and also we'll probably put this on YouTube in the next few days. We also put videos on YouTube for some of the other plane talks we do. I'll leave a stack of business cards here. If you would like to be added to that list or be invited to future events, you can just drop an email that please add me to that list, and we'll do that. So again, thanks to all of you. Have a great evening. Bye-bye.